There, okay, we are recording. Cell phone reminders are always good. Thank you. All right, so this is the closing event for the season for nonviolence. Here in Hawaii, we always called it the season for peace and nonviolence. And some of you I met through the season for peace and nonviolence somewhere along the way many years ago. So it's wonderful to be back together again. And we're here also to honor Jerry Jim Polsky and Diane Tirincione. And when I thought about this, you know, we always traditionally had a peace hero every year. But I thought I really wanted to make it even more special for Jerry and Diane because their contribution has been so big for so long, decades and decades. I know a lot of you are going to share stories from multiple decades of knowing them. So it wasn't enough just to have them be this year's peace heroes, their lifetime peace heroes. You know, they have lifetime awards for actors. I think we can have a lifetime award for peace heroes too. And I think most of you know about the season for nonviolence, but for those who don't, it's 64 days. And the bookmarks for those 64 days are Mahatma Gandhi's Day of Death, all the way to Martin Luther King Jr.'s Day of Death. So that's January 30th to April 4th. And since April 4th is Easter, we thought it was better to hold this event tonight or today. For us here in Hawaii, it's still afternoon. So traditionally, for the season for nonviolence, we like to share interfaith prayer. So I thought we would start today with our interfaith prayers. And because it was started by the Association of Global New Thought, we will start with the New Thought prayers. So we will have Frank sharing one from Ernest Holmes, who is the founder of religious science. And then Reverend Suzanne will share one, because she is a unity minister. We do not have the Baha'i person, but I might just share a Baha'i prayer later from the ones from the United Nations. Okay, would you then? We have, thank Salem.
Prayer for World Peace by Ernest Holmes. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. I know there is but one mind, which is the mind of God, in which all people live and move and have their being. I know there is a divine pattern for humanity, and within this pattern, there is infinite harmony and peace, cooperation, unity, and mutual helpfulness. I know that the mind of man, being one with the mind of God, shall discover the method, the way, and the means best fitted to permit the flow of divine love between individuals and nations. Thus, harmony, peace, cooperation, unity, and mutual helpfulness will be experienced by all. I know there shall be a free interchange of ideas, of cultures, of spiritual concepts, of ethics, of educational systems, and of scientific discoveries, for all good belongs to all alike. I know that because the divine mind has created us all, we are bound together in one infinite and perfect unity. In bringing about world peace, I know that all people and all nations will remain individual, but unified for the common purpose of promoting peace, happiness, harmony, and prosperity. I know that deep within every person, the divine pattern of perfect peace is already implanted. I now declare that in each person and in leaders of thought everywhere, this divine pattern moves into action and form, to the end that all nations and all people shall live together in peace, harmony, and prosperity forever. So it is now.
Thank you, Frank. All right, Reverend Suzanne.
You're muted, Suzanne. Unmute yourself.
Come on, sweetie.
Okay. This is a prayer that is a unity prayer that is well known. It is the one that went on the moon mission, and it's written by James Dillett Freeman. And it speaks to cosmic unity and well-being and peace and nonviolence for all. It is simply this. It is that the light of God surrounds us, each one of us, that the love of God enfolds us, that every bit of us is a beacon of love and that light for all mankind, that the power of God supports and protects us, and that the presence of God watches over us, each one of us, as that incredible compass, that moral compass within that helps us to know what is true and right and good. And that whoever and wherever we are, that God is the infinite intelligence, the power, the omnipotence, to help us make a difference in the world by claiming our divinity. And so we give thanks for the peacemakers and for each one of us in our own way for the path that we've trodden for peace in our own world. And so it is. Thank you, God. Amen.
So it is. Now we have Danny Del Negro.
I am now unmuted. Can you hear me?
Yes.
And this thing too? All right. Yeah. From the Zen tradition, the practice of mindfulness, in a nutshell, it means coming back from being lost in thought and being aware of whatever is happening in each moment. And I'm going to present a song called Mindfulness that I wrote. And a big part of it is about world peace. And it's the idea that if we practice mindfulness in situations with other people, we see them as they are. And it's also about becoming free from the concepts that we hold on to, which oftentimes, if that's happening, that's what causes conflict and war. I'm holding onto my concept and you're holding onto yours. So that's what this is about. And it's my prayer that people will become aware of mindfulness and practice it formally, like while they're sitting, and also in their everyday lives, and especially in interactions with others. And this will indeed lead to a more peaceful world. Mindfulness, it keeps on giving. Mindfulness, joyful living. Mindfulness, we learn to release. Mindfulness can even bring world peace. Life's not so bad, but there could be so much more. More joy, living more fully. Sometimes we get lost in thought. Seems like we miss so much joy, so much beauty. Even difficult times are all a part of life. If we can just be here, we'll be more alive. Mindfulness keeps on giving, mindfulness joyful living, mindfulness. We learn to release. Mindfulness can even bring world peace. Sometimes difficult feelings come. That's okay, but they just won't go away. Sometimes we just hold on, and they just stay. Feelings like I can't really do it. When will I get it together? I'm not good enough. Or feelings about somebody else. What's wrong with them? Putting everyone in a box. He's like that, she's like this. That's the way they are. Lost in concepts, we don't really see who's in front of us. How can we see? How can we let go? Mindfulness, it keeps on giving. Mindfulness, joyful living. Mindfulness, we learn to release. Mindfulness can even bring world peace. How about the big questions? Who am I? What's life all about? Why are we here? Without the answers, we feel lost and confused, even full of fear. I sat down and tried to figure it out. The more I thought, the more confused I got. Just like when we have a technical problem, when I took a break, the answer popped up right in front of me. Because it's mindfulness, it keeps on giving. Mindfulness, joyful living. Mindfulness, we learn to release. Mindfulness can even bring world peace. What about world peace? There's so much conflict at home and abroad. Conflict between human beings, even conflict between human beings and the earth. What about war? Remember those boxed in ideas? I'm holding on to mine, you're holding on to yours. Ignoring that things are always changing. How about we just let go? Let go and be here right now. I see you and you see me the way we are, and we can talk about what's on our minds right now. We can open up, multiply this by 7 billion people. That could bring world peace. Mindfulness, it keeps on giving. Mindfulness, joyful living. Mindfulness, we learn to release. Mindfulness can even bring world peace. So let's try it. Come on back right now. Go ahead and let go of anything we're holding on to. Try it. Mindfulness, it keeps on giving. Mindfulness, joyful living. Mindfulness, we learn to release. Mindfulness can even bring world peace. Can't even bring world peace. I'm talking about joyful living, full on giving, an end to war, peace with the earth, getting along, being our true selves, get the answers every day. Mindfulness. Mindfulness. Just come on back. Be here now. Mindfulness. Thank you very much.
Well, it's not being muted. All right. So as I mentioned, I got a message that our person that was going to share the Baha'i prayer is not feeling well today. So I just have the one from the UN peace prayers. Be a lamp unto those who walk in darkness and a home to the stranger. Be eyes to the blind and a guiding light unto the feet of the erring. Be a breath of light to the body of humankind, a dew to the soil of the human heart, and a fruit upon the tree of humility. Okay, Roger, you're up.
Thank you, Reverend Sue. It's just so nice to see everybody here. If we have a chance to tell a story, Suzanne Cameron shaking her head. Around the time I was at Unity Church, that's when I was meeting Jerry and Diane, mid-90s. Here's a prayer I like from the Jewish tradition. Jerry was raised in a Jewish tradition, but he didn't stay with it too much. But I think this prayer really speaks for him. Osei shalom bimroma hu yasei shalom aleinu. Be'al kol Yisroel, Yaseh shalom, Yaseh shalom, shalom aleinu, be'al kol Yisroel. And I loosely translate that as, whoever brings peace to himself can bring peace to the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Roger. So, Chris?
And I have a prayer for peace from Hazrat Inayat Khan, the prayer from Sufism. Hazrat brought Sufism to America. Send thy peace, O Lord, which is perfect and everlasting, that our soul may radiate peace. Send thy peace, O Lord, that we may think, act, and speak harmoniously. Send thy peace, O Lord, that we may be contented and thankful for thy bountiful gifts. Send thy peace, O Lord, that amidst our worldly strife, we may enjoy thy bliss. Send thy peace, O Lord, that we may endure all, tolerate all, in the thought of thy grace and mercy. Send thy peace, O Lord, that our lives may become a divine vision, and in thy light, all darkness may vanish. Send thy peace, O Lord, our father and mother, that we, thy children on earth, may all unite in one brotherhood and sisterhood. Amen.
Thank you, Chris. And we have the prayer of St. Francis. Laura?
Yeah, am I unmuted? Great, okay. Even though I've followed religious science and unity most of my adult life, this has always been one of my favorite prayers for peace. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not be so much, that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, for it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. And I think if anything, really is the peace prayer for attitudinal healing in Jerry. That's it.
Thank you, Laura. So I'm also sharing the Hindu prayer for peace, because along with religious science, I also have a deep connection with India. Oh God, lead us from the unreal to the real. Oh God, lead us from darkness to light. Oh God, lead us from death to immortality. Shanti, shanti, shanti unto all. Oh Lord God Almighty, may there be peace in celestial regions. May there be peace on earth. May the waters be appeasing. May the herbs be wholesome. And may trees and plants bring peace to all. May all beneficent beings bring peace to us. May the Vedic law propagate peace all throughout the world. May all things be a source of peace to us. And may thy peace itself bestow peace on all. And may that peace come to me also. And then we have a Frank sharing Imagine, which he's tweaked just a little bit.
Yes, yes, well. Okay. Yes, I may just grab the little changes that you'll notice. This is kind of an exercise in imagination. 50 years later, after it was put out there, we still have all the things that he said. What if we did without these things? We could get rid of some of these other things too. So there are some things we'd be better off without. We could just lose them. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Almost only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for. We each work out what's true. Imagine all the people living life in peace. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. Hope someday you'll join us. And the world will end as one. Imagine no possessions. I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger. A family of men. All the people, all the world, you may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us. And the world will be as one.
All right. But I've already shared a little bit about the idea of the peace hero, how we did that every year. Sometimes in the middle of the season, sometimes towards the end of the season. And I think some of the people here have been peace heroes at one time or another. You've all made wonderful contributions to peace and nonviolence in the ways that you do. So I want to honor and appreciate all of you. And thank you so much for being here. In a few minutes, we're going to start sharing our memories and our testimonies about Jerry and Diane, and just give them all the love that we can, because they've loved us so much over the years, taught us so much and given us so much. Like many people, my first exposure to Jerry Jampolsky was through his books. I read all his books long before I met him. And I think even though I lived in California for some time, I met him in person first here in Hawaii. They came over so often and shared with the Forgiveness Project and the season and other things. So I'm going to ask Karen actually to start the sharing, because she wrote this wonderful piece with a lot of factual information about Jerry. And we have a photo that we're going to put up. So if you're ready, Karen.
I'm ready. Okay, well, since Jerry wrote the foreword to my Chicken Soup book, Chicken Soup for the Soul, Children with Special Needs, I thought it'd be quite appropriate to write a story about how I first met Jerry. So fear can be the most virulent and damaging virus known to humankind, as Lee, his son, wrote that Jerry had quoted. So this is my tribute to the late Gerald Jampolsky, a veteran of three wars, Stanford-trained physician psychiatrist for almost 70 years, received the American Medical Association Excellence in Medicine Pride in the Profession Award, World Health Organization 60th Anniversary Award, founder of Center for Attitudinal Healing. First, I'm humbled and elated and honored to write words about Dr. Jerry Jampolsky, the man I've worshiped and cherished since the day I met him in 1992, during his visit to Edmonton, Alberta, to do a conference with Dr. Wayne Dyer and some other top-notch spiritual presenters. As a participant in the audience, I was captivated by each and every word he spoke. First about his being a psychiatrist that used to be an alcoholic, and then teaching to choose love rather than fear, forgiveness rather than resentment, saying goodbye to guilt, and so forth. He spoke of catastrophic illness and healing sick children, as well as helping others through painful situations such as sickness and the death of children. I was hanging on every word because my dear friend and physician for many years, Dr. Vincent Visconti's daughter, who happened to be only 3 years old at the time, had been in a tragic car accident and seriously injured when her aunt's car smashed into a side rail on the freeway. It had coincidentally happened at the same time Jerry was in town for the conference. I mustered up the courage to approach him and ask if he would be willing to go to the hospital to meet with the Viscontis to offer them some prayers of hope for their daughter, Nadia, whose injuries would be so significant as to make her quadriplegic. He agreed and accompanied me to the hospital in my white van. I felt like I was floating on air to have Jerry in the same vehicle as me. The depth of his words, the magnificence of his presence and voice was very powerful. Every word he spoke meant something wonderful, deep and present. What a magical human being. I never wanted the drive to end. We arrived at the hospital 30 minutes later to meet Vince and Asmina Visconti and proceeded to the room where Nadia was hospitalized. As always, Jerry paid attention to coincidences, and Jerry remarked that our common bond was the Italian connection. For at the time, I was married to my late Italian husband, Jim Ciccoli. Vince was, of course, Italian, and Jerry's wife, Diane, Cerencioni was also Italian. Jerry said, Karen, coincidences are God's way of remaining anonymous, which is my favorite quote of his to this day. Jerry spoke kind words to both of them privately, which only he knew how. Of course, Jerry wasn't a magician. Of course, Jerry wasn't a magician, so he couldn't change the situation.
You haven't played your music yet.
I play my life.
Can y'all hear me?
Somebody should mute their phone. They're talking in the background.
Okay. Should I go on?
Okay. Yes.
Of course, Jerry wasn't a magician, so he couldn't change the situation. Rather, he helped them cope with their fear, their sadness, their resentment, their letting go, and their surrender. It's a forever process and one that takes daily practice, and now the Viscontis had some tools to work with. I tell this story to demonstrate one example of how Jerry touched the lives of so many people. In this story, there are so many areas to let go of and to forgive. For example, the anger towards the aunt, the guilt as a parent, the sadness as a physician not being able to fix the problem, and so forth. Such is life, and this is how Jerry worked, turning lives around one life at a time. People's lives, because they all mattered one life at a time. It was all a ripple effect. I could write a book about how passionate and impactful Jerry was every time I came in contact with him. One time when I visited both Jerry and Diane at his home in Hawaii, Jerry remarked how delightful it was to hear the sound of children's laughter and pure unconditional sound of unconditional happiness, joy, innocence, and love as my daughter Christina playfully frolicked in the waves near his home. I still remember to this day how warm he made me and my guests feel in his presence with each and every word that he spoke that day, a treat for a lifetime. Jerry was a teacher of teachers. He changed the world in so many ways that are yet to be realized. Through his words and kind heart and the words that continue to evolve through the work that he has done and the miracles that have come to pass, it is my belief that by truly changing our inner thoughts and beliefs, our world is magically shifting. Jerry made a true impact on humanity, and Diane too, of course. And his words live on forever, continuously transforming and evolving. Let us never forget this wonderful, magical human being that appreciated people no matter who they were and what they were in life. He wanted to help them with his giving heart, kindness, and humanity. Jerry was a gift to the world, and he lives on through all of us. Let us always keep keep him in our hearts and be extremely thankful for all the work he has given mankind, especially through these virulent times we are living through in our world. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Suzanne, would you like to follow that?
Unmute, Suzanne. Unmute, Suzanne.
Unmute. There you go. You got it now.
Ron has so much technology here. So many buttons, levers, and pulleys. Okay. Well, this is a serious yet ecstatically happy occasion for me, because I see some oldie but goodie friends. Roger, it's so good to see you, and Chris, Laura, many of you that knew Jerry and knew me in the days. I remember collaborating with Sue Crane back in early 2000s with the Season for Peace and Nonviolence. And also how fun it was to bring Arun Gandhi to Kauai. That was a very, very special event. I remember taking him to the Hindu monastery. If you've ever been to Kauai and have been up there, you know how very special a place it is. And there we were riding in the little vans with the monks' robes flying in the breeze. And, you know, they were so happy to have have him there, you know, which was the basis of their work, is peace and nonviolence. And so it was wonderful to have him there. But moving back in time, in the 1980s is when I first met Jerry Jampolsky. We were both having lunch at the cafeteria at Unity Village and got to spend some time together there. And from that, because I was at Unity of the Plaza in Kansas City for several years, and my ex-husband was a Unity minister, I had the privilege of being able to bring special speakers to the church to speak. As it turns out, there were only two people at that time in the history of the church that filled the auditorium of 1,000 people. One was Jerry Jampolsky and the other was Ram Dass. They were standing room only. And one of the things was, of course, that Jerry had just begun his work and had brought the Center for Attitudinal Healing in California to fruit. And he especially was able to connect with children, which that was a great part of his early work. So I like to talk about the genius and the heart of Jerry Jampolsky, because the genius was that he could put into practical practice wonderful foundations for truth and well-being and healing within each person. He would take the conceptual and make it work in everyday lives with a twinkle in his heart. And speaking of the heart, here's what he did. In front of 1,000 people, he invited 4 children up on stage with him. Rather than talk about himself, he talked about his work through the children. And my daughter, who was then very young, perhaps 6 or 7, was one of the ones invited on stage. Now, my daughter has always had immune problems, autoimmune problems, and right now she's currently semi-bedridden with Lyme disease. And so at that time, she was manifesting some of the, you know, incredible hard path way that she has lived, you know, with that dis-ease in her body. So Jerry brought Heather in front of him, put his arms around her and said, "You are this special child of God and there is nothing you can't do. You're whole and free, and may the peace of God and love, you know, surround you and enfold you." And a lot of those are my words, but the way he did it with a sparkle and a twinkle, and, you know, we all just felt better by his presence. And so the best part of it, though, was afterwards, he sent a personal letter within the week to Heather, and she'd never gotten a letter before. And so we presented the letter to her. We didn't open it ahead of time. It was her letter. And inside was a personal note from Jerry, filled with little heart sprinkles. And at that time, they were new. I had never seen heart sprinkles before. And they just cascaded all over the way down into her lap and all around. And we all were just, you know, just hearts open. Just, it was such a happy time. So every time I've been with Jerry has been a happy time. And let me tell you about the genius. The genius of Jerry is that he married Diane Cerincione. Absolutely, dear. You are a beacon of light in your own right and a very juicy woman. I salute you for the work that you do now, carrying on in whatever ways you carry on, but mainly the message. Absolutely. So the final thing I wanted to say was that I had an opportunity to be the, let me say I held down the Center for Spiritual Living. All good things are about that, aren't they? the Center for Attitudinal Healing at Unity Diamond Head for many years, and used the principles, had small works going, and we went all around with Jerry and Diane preaching the gospel that the essence of our being is love, which is the very first principle of attitudinal healing, and that health is inner peace and healing is letting go of fear. I know you've heard those words and they will reverberate forever. So much love to you and Jerry, who is twinkling everywhere he still is and spreading love. Thank you.
Did you want to share something, Ron?
Yeah, sorry, a little too fast.
No?
Come on, Ron, you're the technology guy. You've got to be able to unmute yourself.
Okay.
Oh, well, anyways, back again. We felt like, Susie and I felt like we were part of your family. And that made all the difference in the world. I have a picture of Jerry and I sitting on the porch, and I will remember that for as long as I live, just sitting there enjoying Lanikai and being with you. And
those sandwiches, and you made a mean sandwich.
And I really enjoyed working with Jerry. And remember, we did all that voice control on his laptop, and Susie and I were out at your place all the time. We really were part of your family, and we are so blessed. You are loved and appreciated. Just know that.
Thank you. And you bless us with your ongoing friendship over time. Thank you so much, Ron. Thank you, Suzanne. A potpourri of beautiful memories. Thank you so much. So Laura Berry is joining us from the East Coast. It's very late there. We'll let her share next.
While she's awake.
Right.
Oh, or at least coherent. I tend to be a night owl. You know, when I was thinking about this with the season going on, and I wish I had have had the presence of mind to bring it. I think, Sue, you saw it. I had recently run across some pictures. And I was actually looking for some pictures to send to Rune, because we had been talking about the Season for Peace and Nonviolence, and I had some of him and Sananda and all of us at the church. And I ran across a wonderful picture of our attitudinal healing group. And I had actually put it on Facebook and tagged a few people I'm still in touch with. And it was just such a precious memory. But when I got to thinking about it, I didn't realize how young I was when I first became aware of Jerry. It was 40 years ago. I saw him on Phil Donahue doing the program about children dealing with death and dying. And when I started and thought that was a path I was going to take and did work with Elizabeth Cooper Ross and all, it was Jerry's stuff that kept coming back. And even though I did not follow that for long, I really wanted to help people live their lives a little better. It was kind of difficult for me to do that. In ministry, in therapy, in counseling, it was just such a gift to have those tools. And when I came back home to live, and lo and behold, who do I get to meet and to spend time with and learn from? It was one of the highlights. And, you know, of course, Diane, you're just everything Suzanne said and more. You were both wonderful and generous with everyone. But, you know, Jerry just had that light in him. And it was so, such a gift. And even when the group at Unity was not quite doing as much as we were, and I was doing some other things, I'm not sure, my mind fails me a little bit about it, if he ever realized that I was running an attitudinal healing group at the women's shelter in Honolulu. And I cannot tell you the reaction. Sue and I were sharing space at that time, and it would be really amazing to see these women who some were there of their own doing and other circumstances. Many had been on drugs, alcohol, and getting them in that space and getting them to really open up and do that heart connection. Of all the things I did with attitudinal healing, it was probably one of the most precious and meaningful. And I, you know, they didn't know who Jerry was. And I shared books with some of them and everything, but I never got one that in the end did not feel that they got something out of it. And in my own way, I've used it. I've helped a friend introduce to it. She does women's prison ministry. So there's been so many amazing ways that it's been able to touch people's lives, but none any more than my own, and the very privilege of that time and feeling the friendship as well as just, hey, I know him. We went to church together or we did a meeting together is something I will always cherish. You are both amazing people. Your work will go on. It's more timely now than ever. I've actually been thinking I need to get off my Okole and get back out there now that my parents are both gone and what I came back out here to do is past. Dad was Jerry's age and he made his transition in 19. And so blessings for a long time, but yeah. And this just couldn't have been more inspirational than to know that that needs to be a part of whatever my next chapter is. So Jerry, thank you. I know you're watching, and Diane, always.
Thank you so much. Laurie, I don't know if you know, but that for a long time, and maybe today, even at the women's prison in Kailua.
Yes. Yes. And that, in all candor, I knew about that. And what was the girl's name from Unity that did it? Anyway, that sort of inspired me to talk to my friend who was doing that work to say, you need to look at this. You need to figure out a way to incorporate this. And I know she never got into a formal training, but I spent time with her, introduced her to Jerry's work, gave her the basics. And she said, you know, the principles, and she used it and said that she has had a lot of wonderful, wonderful experiences with it. So.
If I could interject, Sue, a sweet story about related to what Laura's saying about the women's prison in Kailua. You know, we lived in Kailua for on and off for like 17 years and had a house over there. And when we first went, there was a couple that we knew that was going over to the prison, the women's facility. And they asked if we wanted to come. And we said, sure, we'd love to. We work in San Quentin. To this day, the group is 45 years old in San Quentin. We still go in twice a year. And there was a woman in the prison who had, somebody gave her a love is letting go of fear. And she said the day before, nobody knew we were coming. She said, if I ever got to meet this person, this would really change my life. And so the next day she goes and they all go in a room, and here walks in Jerry and I in the room. It like blew her mind. And she got out, she became a counselor, she worked with women in prison. I thought you'd enjoy that story. You're muted, Laura, there you go.
Yeah, and that's really amazing, it really is.
Yeah, it is. And one other sweet thing, if I could, Sue, just, this isn't my sharing, but Laura said the prayer of St. Francis before. And many of you, if not all of you, know Hugh Prather and Gail Prather. And Hugh and Gail were our closest friends. And years ago, when we went to Santa Fe to the dispensable church that they had, before we went, a week before, Jerry had on his table, his coffee table, a 12-inch statue hand-carved of St. Francis by an artist in Santa Fe, which he really loved. And a mother was there who had lost her child who passed away. And the mother said, oh, I just like that, love that statue so much. And Jerry's, first his mind said, oh, we'll give her the statue. And then he went, oh God, that's the only thing I'm really attached to. So anyway, he gave it to her. This is a story about abundance. He gave her the statue. That was Wednesday. And on Sunday, we were in the church in Santa Fe giving a talk. And at the end, they brought in the exact same statue that was about, it's about 30 inches tall. It's to this day sits in front of our houseboat of the exact same artist, only it was three times bigger than the other one. And it was such an extraordinary story about letting go and trusting the abundance in the universe. But when you said the prayer of St. Francis, that was Jerry's favorite prayer.
Oh.
Thank you.
All right, who would like to share next? Roger, go ahead.
Thanks, Sue. I was starting to cry a little before, and I just wanted to say what a wonderful blessing it was to have Jerry in my life, and I really appreciate it. And this may be the last time I get to say that, so I wanted to say that and thank you. And Diane, Jerry said, you got him to live 20 years longer, and I knew him 25 years, so thank you for that. Yeah, I wanted just to say a couple of other things. I met Jerry in mid-90s. Robin Rohr called me, and she said, there's two of the most wonderful people in the world who are in Hawaii, and they're looking to do something in the Pacific. And I want you to call them and see if you can get them to do it in Hawaii. And at the time, I was a trustee of the Queens Hospital. And so I got the Queens Hospital to sponsor a program for Jerry and Diane at the Episcopal, St. Andrew's Episcopal Church downtown. And one of the first things I remember is asking them something about what they were gonna say. And Jerry said, oh, we never know what we're gonna say. We just go on and say it. But the upshot from that meeting was they met some people, including Alvin Shim's wife, who used to work for my law firm. She called me, she said, they're wonderful. She was at the Episcopal Church. She introduced them to Alvin. Alvin introduced them to all the legislators. And it was, well, Diane, you said you were here 17 years. So that was a great start. And Merton Chin was there. And just one other memory for me, as I look around at the Unity Church people, Suzanne Cameron Stover, we started bringing our kids to Unity and I worked for her. She was the family therapist. Chris Miller brought his kids at the same time. And Diane and Jerry, of course, are my connection through Unity Church. So it just feels like a really nice homecoming. And then the last thing I want to say is the Attitudinal Healing of Hawaii group has managed to keep its board of directors together. Trish is now free of her chemotherapy treatments, but we haven't done much. But yesterday, I put together the last piece for a woman named Joey Rise, who's been doing Jerry's work and some other work, some forgiveness work around Honolulu. And we just got, we haven't gotten the money yet, but we're gonna get a very substantial $100,000 grant for Joey to continue under the Attitudinal Healing of Hawaii banner to keep doing Jerry's work. So I want everybody who's in Hawaii to know that in case you want to try to reconnect. We've, like I said, kept it going, but it's been hard to do any of the programs. But we're very optimistic that this is, just after Jerry's passing, a nice way to reignite 25 years and many, many years before that of his work in Hawaii.
So Roger, you are a friend beyond friends, Roger, to Jerry and I. We love you dearly. And you always have that beautiful Jewish connection for Jerry.
Well, I'm really glad to be able to do it today too, because we are Landsmen, you know? And we knew how we grew up together, and Jerry called me his brother and I loved him. And Sue, thank you for giving me this chance to cry a little bit, because I haven't before.
We loved you very, very much, Roger, and I do too. And I love the close connection we've kept and continue to keep all these years. I'll see you in Oahu in September or early October.
Okay, terrific. Let me know when your dates are so I'll be sure I can be here.
I will, yes.
Thank you, dear.
Mm-hmm. So, oh, Roger, wonderful news about the attitudinal healing. Chris, would you like to share?
Yes, if I can unmute my microphone. I loved so much what Jerry and Diane brought. And really, it was kind of like meeting heroes in my life. And I know that we see those everyday heroes that, you know, really make life work for so many. And then there are those exceptional ones that can take really complex ideas, impossible things, and make them look easy. And what I loved about what Jerry and Diane carried into the world is decoding a sacred aspect of life and making it available to all of us around love and compassion. You know, the most important and the most complex parts of living in many ways, how to maintain connection, especially when there is disconnection. And they made it amazingly simple for me. And so I went through the program and I loved having the times I had, which were not that, you know, there were brief interludes when Jerry and Diane would come into program that I was involved in, and I had a chance to see them. And what really also struck me was an accessibility that such brilliance rarely offers. The very open-hearted humanness that I experienced with Jerry and you, Diane, to really let people in, because when world teachers show up, they usually don't allow that kind of accessibility. And it actually made it even more real for me that you both could bring this heartfulness, this open-hearted sharing and caring, and make it seem so simple that we can all say, well, yes, I can do that too. Yes, I can take that into the world, and I too can find ways to share. And it's, Jerry, you know, I'm still struck by the strength and gentleness of the man, that he, you know, offered this genuineness and open-heartedness that just was very moving to be around. And you too, Diane, that you both brought this strength that, well, we all need, you know, the ability to persevere amidst, you know, very challenging experiences of the world that we're all looking to weather. So I'm just so grateful and appreciative of my chance to have, you know, time and learning from you two heroes in my life.
Takes one to know one. It takes one to know one, Chris. Thank you so much for those beautiful thoughts.
Is there anyone else that would like to share?
Deidre,
go ahead and unmute.
I won't use the three famous words from the COVID era, you are on mute. I want to read a very short little Hafiz that always reminds me of Diane and Jerry. I wish I could show you, when you're lonely and in darkness, the astonishing light of your own being. Mm-hmm. And I remember meeting both of you. I say I remember, but I don't remember the date. I just remember the event. It was in California at a conference, and how both of you had an incredible facility to bring home home. Being with you was immediately a sense of acceptance, non-judgment, curiosity, and love. And if anything makes my memory of both of you so precious or treasured, it's that I've tried to learn that from you. So thank you.
Well, we've learned so much from you, Diederik, and your work in Vancouver and Costa Rica and in Europe and with so many young people and adults. And thank you so many times over as a counsel for us, as a brother in this work. Thank you.
Thank you, sweetheart.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Choose once again.
Choose then again.
Hi. Is there anyone else? I can't see everybody, so if you want to share, just unmute. No? All right, then. We have a special song. Dan is going to lead us in. And we have the words up, so you can sing along. But muted.
All right.
So this is for you, Diane, and for all of you. All of you on the call.
Can you hear this?
Karen Drucker has been a friend of Attitudinal Healing for decades. And she's in the Northern California area. And it was lovely to hear her song. Thank you.
All right. So, you can see it. This is the official award.
Oh, beautiful.
So Lifetime Peace Hero Award awarded to Jerry Jampolsky and Diane Cirincione for their decades of dedication to forgiveness, healing, peace, and nonviolence. So I just have to get this to you in the physical, Diane.
Thank you. Thank you. I look forward to getting that. I'll put that right in Jerry's office. Thank you so much, Sue. Would you like me to share a little bit right now? I have a couple of thoughts. You know, the Gandhi, the season for nonviolence, Gandhi's famous words, I'm sure we all know that, you know, there is no road towards peace, that we are the road. There is no path to peace, that we are the path. And that, you know, for Jerry and I, and I really feel Jerry's essence here, and he's shown up in so many ways, but that's a whole other conversation. Every morning of the near 40 years of our time together. We would wake up in the morning and greet the morning, we called it. And it's on our website under downloads. But a part of that is that it starts with something from A Course in Miracles called, I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still as God created me. I want the peace of God. The peace of God today is everything that I want. It's the aim of all my living here, the end that I seek. It's my purpose, my function, and my life while I abide where I'm not at home. Every single day we set that as our goal. That we, instead of having multiple goals, like I want to do this, I want to do that, we said, no, we're going to have one goal. And that is peace of mind, peace of God, and a harmony, integrity in what we think, what we say, and what we do. And everything else is going to be our intention. Every morning we said it out loud before we get out of bed. And I still do it. I lean over like I'm reaching Jerry's hand in the morning and I say it out loud now, 3 months after his passing. And it reminds us also that we would also say today, and we would say the date that I'm the light of the world, and so are you, and so is everybody else. And today, we renew a vow every single morning that we took almost 40 years ago. When Jerry asked me if I would hold his heart gently, I knew it was a strong request. It was a lifetime request. And I said, yes. And I said, would you hold mine? And he said, yes. And I said, Jerry, if we're going to do that, you and I have the gift of words. And we can either use our words to heal, to join, or to separate and slay. And so if we're going to be that vulnerable to each other, I'm going to ask if you would take a vow with me and say to never ever use words as weapons against another person, either each other or anyone else. And Jerry, together with me, made that vow. And that is one of the ways that we kept peace in our lives. Jerry and I, anybody that's been around us knows exactly, we are incredibly honest and direct and forthcoming, articulate in our dialogues, our discussions, but don't use words as weapons. And that's one way that we hold peace on earth, for each of us. And I am so grateful to say that we never broke that vow, not with each other or with anyone else. And it was specific. We had to really think about it, because I think peace is something that you do think about. And one of the beautiful things about Jerry's passing, Judy Scutch Whitson, who gave him the manuscript for A Course in Miracles, and our dearest, dearest friend. One of her very last conversation with Jerry on the phone, we would visit with her every week. The last conversation on the phone, she said, Jerry, how are you doing? And he said, Judy, I'm still learning. And every day I just wake up with that. And two things I want to share with you. Someone sent me the other day a copy of a recording we did years ago with Tony Robbins, Anthony Robbins. And we've gotten more letters, emails, conversations about that. I never kind of remembered what it was. It was about relationships. And I thought, that's probably the most popular thing people have talked about. So I listened to it and it was really pretty good. But then there was a part of it where he asked me and then he asked Jerry. And kind of gave the same answer. He said, what do you want your legacy to be? And Jerry and I kind of looked at each other and went, well, we kind of like aren't really interested in a legacy. We're just kind of like interested in now and how much we can love now and how much peace we can experience now and how much integrity we can have in the way we live our lives. But neither of us are really pretty much interested in legacies. And a lot of people have asked about Jerry's passing, et cetera. And I shared with our beautiful Hawaii community not long ago with something that Roger hosted for the Forgiveness Project. And someone just sent me something the other day, and I want to share it with you because to me, it really represents a way of holding someone that you love so dearly that is no longer here in form. And I'd like to share it with you. It's by a woman named Elizabeth Ammons. She has a website called Lessons learnedinlife.com. And this is what she wrote. You can shed tears because they're gone, or you can smile because they lived. You can close your eyes and pray that they'll come back, or you can open your eyes and see all that they left for you. Your heart can be empty because you can't see them anymore, or you can be full of the love that you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember only that they're gone, or you can cherish their memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind and feel empty, or you can do what they would want, to smile, to open your heart, to love, and to go on. I share that for you, for Jerry. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, Diane. That's beautiful. Oh.
Diane, I'd love to get a copy of that poem.
Thank you, Roger. I was specifically thinking of you when I read it.
I'd really love to get a copy if you could send it. Thank you.
I'd like a copy too.
Okay. Let's see now. Who can I send it to? Directly there to go, Karen. I've got your email. I've got Rogers. I can also send it to you.
I think Sue has everybody's.
Sue, can I send it to you?
Sure.
And then you can send it out. Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
Hi, Barbara. Let's just send it to Barbara too. Okay. Thank you, everyone. This has been absolutely lovely. My heart is full. And I feel Jerry's presence and essence here, and he's everywhere. I said to someone the other day something I had never said before. I said, you know, it's amazing. People feel like when someone goes that they just take part of you with them. I don't feel like any part of me is missing. I feel like Jerry left so much behind that I feel like more than I was before. Even before Jerry passed, I feel like there's so much more now. It's like me plus Jerry. So I say that for you, because for all the people that he loved, and each and every one of you and so many others that feel that love, feel him, talk to him, ask him questions. Believe me, he actually answers. Oh, sorry. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane. And thank you to all of you. We thought we would close with the siren song for unity and religious science, Let There Be Peace on Earth. I'm pretty sure most of you know that song. So Dan is going to lead us in that.
Can we unmute and sing it together, Sue?
I think we'll get a lot of echo if we do that.
Okay.
What?
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Dan.
And thank you again to all of you. I will have the recording. I'm probably going to upload it to Google Drive, and I'll send you the link. And then when Diane sends me that poem, I'll send that as well.
Nice to have some email addresses. I'd like to follow up with a couple of you folks.
Yeah, I've got one for you, but it's probably not the right one.
Okay, this is good. Well, all right.
Thank you, Sam, for hosting so much.
You're welcome.
Okay. Thank you, Sue. Thank you, Diane.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone. It was very beautiful.
It was.
Thank you, Danny.
Thanks for being on, Jenny. Okay.
All right.
Good night, everyone.
And happy Easter again.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter. Aloha.
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 I'm right here.